I remember when I was working in this ward, a psychiatric ward, there came a young woman and she had recently given birth to a child. And they talked about her at the ward, the doctor and some of the nurses, they talked about her that she was psychotic. And I remember that I, just after a few hours, I thought to myself, how the hell will she be able to act in a normal way? Being here in a ward and she has her baby at home. And this is 30 years ago, but I still remember it very, very clear. She was just left in her room, and in the corridor there were lots of other so-called patients walking around. And the next day her husband came to visit her for a short while, and he brought the baby, and she met her little baby for, let's say, 10 minutes. And then a nurse came and said, end of this visit, and you have to go now. And then she got mad. Crazy. I think she was overwhelmed by grief. I think she was furious, and she screamed and she banged on the windows. And I thought to myself, this is absolutely normal to behave the way she did. But the people talked about her that now she's even more psychotic. We need to give her even more medicine.
Carina Håkansson created the Family Care Foundation in Gothenburg, Sweden, as an alternative mental health program for people who had been failed by the conventional system. Many had been labeled with psychosis by traditional psychiatry. They placed people on an entirely voluntary basis in farm families in the Swedish countryside.
What is special about Maria?
Maria? My therapist.
Mm.
She's very, very good. Very good, actually. You can talk to her about everything. And she's so understanding and grateful. And I'm very happy to have her as a therapist.
Their organization then provided supportive supervision to the farmers who had been chosen not on the basis of any psychiatric expertise, but instead for their stability, their compassion, and their desire to give back. The families were also paid a small fee, but all services to the clients, who were also offered intensive psychotherapy, were free.
You've had other therapists before her?
Yes. On the other institution.
What were they like?
Not like her. Not like her at all. Not at all. They didn't care at the same way. Same way. She's very special.
When I was 20, I think, one of my friends got the diagnosis of schizophrenia, I think. And I was with him when he got his first episode. Yes, first episode. So later on, a few months later, he was locked in at that hospital. So when I work at one part of the hospital at the lunchtime, I went to him at his part, and he was a strange, my classmate who helped me with maths.
And suddenly he's locked up.
And he was strongly medicated. Oh, where is he now? It was so strange he is. So that was, I think it has made a lot impression. So it has influenced me a lot.
I'm not so good at English.
I think your English is good.
No, it was better when I was, there's a sick moon, but it was easier to talk English for me when I was on hospital, when I was a psychotic.
It was easier to talk?
Yes, it was.
Why?
I don't know. I was in a fantasy world, you know. I was... And I was in love with Johnny Depp, and I don't know, I had dreams about him and everything. I was very sick. I learned more English or something. Yes, more English and American English in my dreams and everything.
This is a nice place for your son to live?
Yes.
He's happy here?
Yes, he's very happy.
Why, would you say? He has love here, I guess?
Yes. He wants to stay here with me, but I don't know what's going to happen now.
Oh, because the social services says they don't want to pay anymore?
No, they don't want me to stay here with him. And because it's... I don't know. They don't think I'm getting better.
Do you agree?
No, I don't agree. I agree with the family company, Care and Honor. Or foundation, I mean.
So, yeah, you think you're getting better?
Yes.
It seems to me.
Okay, I have my problems, but I'm getting better anyway.
Oops. Let me make sure I get this right. It's hard to do camera and talk at the same time.
It goes like this all the time. Up and down.
But you
never know when it's coming.
You think you will be able to get off your medication?
Yes, I hope so.
And they support you here to come off your medication?
Yes, absolutely.
The family?
Yes.
And also the organization, Family Care Foundation?
Yes, and the psychiatrist.
The psychiatrist.
So they believe in you?
Mm. You want some?
Okay. This should not be on camera.
No.
I'm supposed to be the perfect... Here, you can film me if you want. I think many of my clients that I worked with in New York, as when I was their therapist, I think they would do better in the program here in Sweden than just coming to therapy in the United States. I think this is a better system.
Okay.
Because I think therapy sometimes, or often, is just not enough. When people have serious problems, they need more than what I could offer. And I gave my heart. But people need more.
It's not about medication, it's about people and people. giving love to people.
The first time I came to Sweden was last year. I came for 2 hours.
Okay.
Then I came the second time. 3 months ago, I came for 6 days, and this time, I've been here for 2 weeks, filming everything about Family Care Foundation and going all over, driving in the car all over Sweden and trying to find out if this program, Family Care Foundation, is really good.
Okay, and you found out what?
I think it's wonderful.
Yes. You have to have love to help people. If you don't have love, you cannot help.
It's funny, because I look around and it just seems like from the outside, it looks like just an average home. But it seems like from the inside, there's something special in there.
This is. It's very warm inside. Very much love.
What made you both decide to do this, to take people into your homes like this? Because this is, it's not common.
No.
Nobody does this in the United States, very rarely.
When I was 13 years old, I lived in, like Therese, you do now, in a family in 7 years, and worked on a farm. That helps me a lot to be what I am today.
Sometimes I felt that I had every diagnosis in the world.
I get a man who taught me how to live life. He taught me to think before I did something and take it easy. I was wild, I fight, I did much foolish stuff. And he taught me almost everything I learned in life in that time.
I lost myself as a person, you can say. So I had to build everything up in myself again.
And if I hadn't lived there, my life probably had looked in another way today. So that was he's in a way saved me. And my thoughts then, I didn't realize the importance of it then. But when I got my own kids, and they became teenagers, and then I remember my time as a teenager.
It was not easy to build me up again as a person and as a parent.
It was then I began to think what we can do to help, because my
my vision
is that all people have responsibility for each and another, right? And we must help. Today we helping Therese. Next year maybe Therese helps us. Who knows?
Do you ever talk to this man who helped you?
He's dead now.
The family care staff let me participate in several of their staff meetings. Through this, I came to realize that they operated differently from how I was taught to behave as a therapist back in the United States. Rather than being blank slates, they instead struggled toward authenticity. I found this both intense and refreshing.
I have had the privilege in my life, but also in my professional life, not to be one of those who had to give up myself and to be a kind of dead person, as I think so many people are working out there. And that is also such a... I really think right now it's one of the most important things for me by... that I didn't have to do that. And of course I also worked for not being one of those, but it has so much to do with the system and where you are and how you do it, and that I can still be alive. That's what I'm trying to say, because I think many people out there are not alive anymore. They are dead. And it's not good
to
be a dead one working with other people who struggle with life and death all the time.
Dead or plågade, vad heter det?
Tortured. Mm. Tortured. Mm. Yeah. No, I think dead. What I mean by dead is something has not feeling enough, not getting attached enough. That's what I mean by dead.
I think hibernating.
What is hibernating?
Bjorn in the winter.
Mm. Oh, okay. Okay. Okay.
The bears in the winter, they go in, you know, underground.
Yeah. But I prefer the word dead, because I want to use the strong word.
That's
because
strong.
I think it has to do. That is what I try to say. I think I've found out because we work in a context when people are struggling with life and death. And therefore I use the word dead, because if you meet a person who is in a way dead, it's dangerous.
I had worked a couple of years before we started Family Care Foundation in an organization where they also included family homes, which is a kind of foster home. And I felt as if there was something the way they did it that seemed to be very important, but I had no words for it. It was just a feeling. I had not that very good experiences from my own life. Good experiences.
You mean your childhood?
My childhood. Good experiences, but also not good experiences. So I cannot say that I am someone who hallelujah for the family. So it was not that it was families. It was something more the way the families behaved.
Now we visit the home of Anki and Jonas Svensson, two farmers who, along with their sons, have been working with the Family Care Foundation for nearly 20 years. They've had many people live in their home, and they have a healing gift that caught me by surprise.
I must say, when I came here today, and also now when sitting here, I got so many memories.
Mm. We got many memories.
Yes. Yeah, we do have together. Yeah. But it was just all. So I feel a bit touched about that. All the people who have passed your house. Mm. I told Daniel about... I started to tell a little bit about... But then I thought it would be better if you could...
He was a father, refugee. He had two small kids. The youngest was 6 months. The older boy was a year and a half. He needed some help to cope with the children. And he was left alone. His wife has been psychotic.
Yes. Yeah.
So he was left alone with two young children. He was age of 42, I guess, when he came here. And he needed a lot of help. He didn't speak Swedish. He didn't speak English. He spoken a little bit Italian. So we few words in Italian made him happy. And
he lived with you?
He lived with us.
With his children?
With his children, 1.5 years.
Yes.
And he got to learn Swedish.
While he was here?
While he was here, slowly. His place in the world, he didn't know what should it become of me. No. Or
it was a kind of breakdown, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, it was a really breakdown.
A really breakdown. It was a bit nuts at the time, I think. Yeah. It was.
He lay on the floor and screamed. And
for
42 years old, who doesn't speak Swedish, lay on the floor and scream.
Yeah.
What to do?
Experience.
What did you do?
Just being human. You don't know if you are told, as I told you now, what would you do when it happens to you? You don't know that now. You don't. But when you are in the situation,
you feel it.
You be human.
Don't be sentimental, for God's sake. Do your job.
I'm being human too. It's very hard to hold a camera steady and cry.
If you want to break, just tell.
I'm joking.
No, I catch me. See.
Crap day and piosk. This is piosk.
Nah,
we have our moments too.
I tell you, in my favorite interviews, I always cry.
Oh.
I can't stop. I always cry. Because it touches me, you know?
Mm.
But
we have lots of memories together.
Oh, yeah.
20 years of memories.
Yes.
And I don't know how many, but it's not relevant, but lots of people have been here. And it's not just only them who lives here. If it's a mother with children, or father with children, or it's a single person, it's so many people around them, and so many people around us. So we are, it's a whole community who is involved. And we have the office down in Gothenburg, and it's a lot of people.
Yes, it is.
You mean that if you choose to be dead, you can live a comfortable life?
Yeah. I think people, because how, I mean, I, as many other people, I think, I try to understand how come that people do like this. How come that people, as this psychiatrist, for instance, working with one of my youngsters, gives him a huge amount of medication every month since he was a little child. How comes that so many parents do like this instead of taking a fight for their kids? I mean, how come?
Yeah, good question.
And for me, the explanation has been, by some reason, they have been or decided to put away the feelings, to put away the things that makes us human beings. And that is for me to be dead.
I am very glad for the connection with the girls who has lived here. I think she was 17 years old when she got here.
Yeah.
She hurt herself very bad. She's
self-destructive.
Now it's coming a very loud
bang.
I think.
No? Poof.
The electricity went away.
Yes. It's far away, yes.
Yeah.
Was 17 years old when she came here to us. Now she lives in.
Whing, the light went on.
Yes, now she lives in and have a normal life.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. She handled his life and.
Is she 25 now?
Yeah, 26.
26.
In this year, yes.
Yeah.
It was many difficult days.
Yeah.
With.
She cut herself while she was living here?
Yes.
In the beginning, yes, she did.
Yes.
Really much.
Really much and really bad.
Yeah.
Like what kind of stuff? Like blood everywhere and
Yeah.
I get angry to her because she was verbal.
Totally verbal.
Yeah, she was very stupid, and I tried.
What, saying verbally abusive?
Help me.
So on hemska saker.
Yeah.
Yes, she did. Yes. To us, you mean?
Yeah.
Like,
fuck you, that kind of thing.
Okay, yes.
But this time, she took his table and whoosh, on me. with teacups and everything. I totally was... What is it? And she was very, very angry. And she... throw things to me in his room.
In her room.
And I got, wow! I see a 5-6 years old little girl, and I think I must do something.
But she's older than that, right? She's like,
She was 17, 18 years old.
Yes. And I took her and grabbed his arms, and I sit on her on her bed, and I said, "Now it's stop!" And I was very angry.
Yeah.
I was
furious.
Furious, you were.
And I hold her there, and she tried to, but no, you're still there. And I, after a half minute, she began to cry, and I.
Yes,
and I sit down and hold her and say, stay here, try to stay here, we work it out, but it can take a year or two, but try to stay here.
So you didn't
friend.
Throw her out?
No. I talked to Margaret Magan, I call her and talk to her, and talk to you. And we meet again, and she stay here, and I have her in my heart.
When I first heard about the Family Care Foundation, I came to the conclusion that the family homes alone were responsible for the healing work. Yet it was the family homes themselves, mostly speaking off-camera, who dissuaded me from this idea. Not a one felt they could have done their job so effectively without getting respectful supervision from the staff and without having respectful therapy offered to the people living with them. This collaborative effort, they felt, made everything possible.
I had an idea that I wanted to try together with others to create a place that should be good for people to stay in. And that was the goal with the organization. That was the vision. But I think that I knew that the place should not just be good for those called clients, but also for us working in the organization. I knew that.
We know each other, and we trust each other that do the works. Because if I have an individual therapy with a boy, and Magan or some other of my colleagues work with his parents, and maybe Maria supervises the family homes. We trust each other in the work, and I think that the whole team feels that we could yell at each other, we could say we don't agree with you. That's not so tough to do that. And I think the people that we meet, they feel that. It's makes a, what should I call, a culture of what's okay to talk about.
I, not always, but mostly I feel that, oh, I talk too much.
What, with your clients?
Yeah, the clients. Oh, I ought to be more quiet, listening, lay back. But yet it's not me. But I don't try to be, to say things that, oh, listen to me, I have the true, I say the true most important things. I try not to be that important by myself, not with that authority. So in some ways, I said, well, this is, I find very important. This, I really believe this is important. But I try to let the person find the thinking and what is important. I talk a lot, but I think, oh, you don't have to listen. You can relax. And I hope part of it, if part of it is interesting, I hope she react on that, and I would try to talk about that.
To meet people exactly where they are. And not taking anything for granted. You know, they come in here with the problems, with their labels and diagnosis. I don't think we give a damn about what people, other people, is telling about that. We have a way of meeting people. We're not labeling them or diagnose them. Just meet them and see what they come with and what they want. And I think that's respectful.
None of us like to be penetrated or analyzed in a way that makes us feel as if we have lost ourselves. No one. And especially not those called psychotic. Especially not them.
What do you think causes psychosis?
What do we think?
Causes.
Yeah, trauma.
Have you ever seen anyone who had psychosis who didn't have trauma?
No, never.
So you think behind psychosis is always
but
trauma?
But sometimes it's hard to catch what the trauma is. Very often, very obvious too. But sometimes you can find these obvious things. But that's life. You can. There's so much that isn't seen from the outside.
I think I would like, if I got this experience of psychosis, that somebody took the time to sit down and try to understand what I was saying. I would like that. Not leave me somewhere in a room with the only drugs to take everything away, but trying to understand what I was saying.
I guess we all need that.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the way I think also. It's not different departments, it's a scale. And you are somewhere on the scale.
Of psychosis, yeah. Or not, or whatever.
Yeah, I think so. And what is for all of us is that we want this. You want to be asked, you want to be looked at, you want to be confirmed, or what the word is. Everybody wants that. It's a basic human stone that we have to build on. And not to do this with people with these experiences is so stupid, I think. It's stupid. Of course, they need it even more. I can take it if I don't get it in a week or whatever. I can take care of it myself. I maybe don't feel so good and maybe I miss it and so on. But these people are depending on that another person looks at you and asks you how is it and try to listen what you say and try to interact.
I think people I work with hopefully feel that they are welcomed when they come. All of us have a need to be included. To be included means that I also show something from myself. Otherwise, it is impossible to have that feeling.
Although Enki and Jonas presented themselves as ordinary people, it struck me that their home was anything but ordinary, to the degree that I realized I was witnessing a radical therapy model. and it made me curious and inspired this film. Who were these people? How did they work? What was their secret? And why did I feel so quickly safe with them? Safe enough to reveal myself so deeply.
We have connection with several amounts of people who have lived here.
Yes.
The first girl who lived here
70 years ago.
91, 92, 93. 93.
So you were just
a
little boy.
She called just another day. She was pregnant when lived here.
Yes. Can we try to not say the names?
Yes, we should
okay.
try to say.
Because what I think I will do is, if you do say the names, when time, if I use if I use the video and you say the name, I go beep during the name.
Yes.
I have to.
That's good. But it's
really hard
to not. They are. I don't know.
I know, and this is good because I tried to explain to Daniel the other day, because. As I think Daniel was a little bit annoyed with me since I didn't want to say client.
Why do you not like to use the word client or patient?
It doesn't fit in the context where I work, because, I mean, in my daily work, I call people their names. And in a family home, they are not a client. It's Pelle or Anna or Maria or Stefan. I mean, the family home never talk about Anna as the client.
They never do?
No.
What do they say then?
Anna.
What do they say to
Anna.
Their friends? Anna is living with us.
Yes, Anna.
But they I don't believe that, to be honest.
Yeah.
I think that they're telling people, we've got someone who's from social services who's living with us in our home, and they've got serious problems of this variety.
Yeah.
Right?
Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. It's different. There are people who stay in a family home who really don't want to be known in their surrounding as someone with troubles. So sometimes people make an agreement with a family home to say that it is a cousin.
Mm. But they tell their friends the truth, or they tell their...
No, I think that most of the family homes tell their friends that Anna, but they say Anna is staying with us since she has had lots of troubles for many years. They don't say, I don't think they say, we have a client living in our home.
Right. But yeah, I guess I hope it's, is it okay that I'm doing...
Of course.
Okay, because I get frustrated when people won't define the role sometimes.
Okay.
Because it becomes this long explanation that, to be honest, nobody can understand what you're talking about.
Okay.
I said, but we don't use the word client.
We talk
about and
yeah.
So, and can you understand that now then? Good.
Mm-hmm.
But when I have read into my diary,
put a beep on.
I have said my friend.
Please, when the name comes up, put the beep on.
The name friend instead of the real name.
Yeah.
Say that again. In what?
When I have read.
You write a diary.
Yes, I write and I have.
When I
talk about it, yes. I have used my friend when
not,
I have.
Not the name.
Not the name. I have said my friend.
And you mean that?
Yes,
friend.
I really mean that. It's my. It is my friend. They
so it's not your client?
No.
Not when they enter in here.
No. We are all people. We are all people. With difference.
Small
problems.
Or bigger
problems.
Small
problems
or
bigger.
Problems.
Yes, you have it. You have grown up in it.
So you've seen this your whole life, mostly?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was four years when we started.
Yeah.
And now I can tell the story. When we started to work together, and you were four or five, and your younger brother was two years younger, and I used to come to see your parents.
Yeah.
And in the beginning, you didn't know what to think about me coming and taking your time from your parents. Mm-hmm. So you used to make a trap.
Yes.
So that I should not be able to go into the house.
Oh, really?
Do you remember that?
So you didn't like her at first?
I think
she stole time from their parents.
But did you feel that way about the people who came in to live with your house, the people that she sent to live here? Did you feel that they were stealing time too?
No, that's no. Another thing. To live here or just to come here and visit us, it's been a family member if you are living here.
Yeah.
Really? So were you sad when they would leave?
Sometimes, no. Sometimes don't.
It depends. No.
Yeah.
When the small depends. Children left, we all... The
cried. Yeah, we cried, all of us. Oh, so did all. I.
So you've all seen each other cry.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So when I come and cry, it's okay.
No, it's not.
So why not?
I mean, no, I don't know. I just don't want you to.
No, why not?
I don't know. No.
Does it bother you?
No.
No, no.
No, because you've seen a lot of tears in this house.
Yeah, I've seen it. I've seen it.
You've seen the tears too?
Yeah, many, many times.
But why did you think he cried? I know it, you said, yes.
Yeah, I know why you cry.
Why?
You will be touched about the story, about the commitments, about there is people who is caring about other people. I get... What heter det? Rörd. Touch. If I heard a story like that came from nowhere, I will be touched too.
Yeah.
I can sit in the living room and watch the TV.
Yeah.
I felt it.
Yeah. Well, also, because I was a psychotherapist in New York City, and I work out of my home. People come to my home with many of the same problems. Mm. People who cut themselves, people who diagnosed with schizophrenia, bipolar, people who want to kill themselves. Mm. And...
We live with them all the days.
Now you will see our Milsan as a
very,
chicken.
Very yellow.
As a chicken.
Yeah.
He is yellow clothes.
Hello. Sorry, there's a camera going.
Hey.
Hey, Paul. Kul att se dig.
Det är samma, det är samma. Du har ju blivit en vuxen man.
Jag har blivit det. Ja, vad kul.
He has become a grown-up man. We haven't met for some years.
Okay.
Years?
Nej, du och jag har väl inte det. It's some years.
Oh, he's got good tattoos.
5-6 years.
No. Där då träffade du Pierre, tror jag, många
ett
par gånger.
Ja. Ja, men hur många år sedan är det?
Ja, men alltså det är så länge sedan är det inte.
Är det inte det? Så 5 år sedan, jo.
Maybe. Ja, kanske.
Jo,
he has moved out from home 3 years.
Okay, then I haven't seen you maybe for 5 years. Mm. But when you were there it felt as if it was yesterday.
Hey, don't you look at it?
It's okay, you cry. Because it's the part of our lives. We cried, we laughed, we are happy, we are sad. I think it's good. It's good for us to show what we feel. And I think you think we have lived so many people here and we have been angry and we have been crying.
It could be usual that sons never have seen a father cry like that, you know. But our sons have seen me cry tremendously sometimes.
Yes.
It is. And so they don't have that burden, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That they haven't seen their father cry. I think it is an asset to have seen their father cry. Myself, I never saw my father cry.
And I think if we show who we are, we cry, we laugh, we get angry, I think the people who come here to us and see us, they
we
just
no
wonder,
from
but
else.
Yeah, no, I think they think, oh, it's really normal people, and they can show themselves after that.
Yeah.
By this point in our meeting, I felt I had established enough rapport with the Svenssons to ask an important question on my mind. Why they thought people living with them got better. In my experience, most clinicians in mental health programs in the United States have never seen someone labeled with psychosis get well. So much so that they are skeptical that full recovery is even possible.
So you see people with very serious problems, and you've seen them get well, change and grow.
Yes, yes.
What do you think is the magic? Why do they get well?
That was a very difficult question, but...
Is it a magic?
No, is it a magic? I think it is the whole family. And I also think that our dogs will help.
Animals in the barn.
The animals.
Mm-hmm. Routines.
Yes, routines.
That's very important.
Mm-hmm.
Routines.
Routines.
Then
is
we
very
have
important.
The stock cows. You have to go out and milk them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a very important thing to have the routines
mm-hmm.
to yes. lay back on.
Mm-hmm.
Well, whatever happens, you have to go out and
yes.
to take care of the cows.
Yes.
No matter what happens, meaning no matter what problems you have.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You can be crazy for a half minute or a minute, but the cows, they call at you and they will have their food and they will be milked. I said to the girl, I can't stand here anymore. We must get out and get the cows food. Oh yes, yes, we should.
And she did it.
She followed me, yes. And she got there and she talk and the cows, they think, okay, there is she again, okay, but get me
mm-hmm.
my food.
The cows trust her?
Yes.
And then she came to me
mm-hmm.
for therapy twice
mm-hmm.
a week. And at that time she didn't talk to me either.
No.
She just talked by herself and
mm-hmm.
shouted by herself. But she used to tell about the cows.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember the first time I thought that it seems as if some kind of connection has started was when she described how she cleaned the cows
mm-hmm.
and gave them food.
Yes.
So I remember that
mm-hmm.
very well. She talked a lot about the cows.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
A lot. Both about the existing cows, but also about cows, fantasy cows
mm.
and fantasy bulls. And
yeah,
it's
like
a little difficult to talk about, but do you remember where she cleaned them?
In the bottom.
Yes.
And
where
yeah.
she
was? Always.
Yeah.
Always.
Like, we used to inseminate our cattle
yeah.
and cows by ourselves. Anki had that education to do that. And when you're doing that, you enter in the bottom of the cow,
yeah.
you know,
yeah,
and,
yeah.
and put in a pistolet
yeah, yeah.
with a sperm, and you clean out what do you call it, the poo.
Yeah, the
yeah,
poo.
Yeah, and it will be messy, and
yeah.
you have
the gloves on.
Yeah,
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 yeah.
Precis-
I've seen it.
Yeah. And they get messy. In the bottom, they met with poo and everything, and she was really what you call noggrann.
She was very aware.
Aware,
yes.
and they shouldn't seem like that. She
no.
shouldn't stand it. She get paper, she washed them so they look nice.
Hmm.
They don't want to be ashamed to look like that in
yeah,
the bottom.
And that was what she told me
yeah.
when she came.
Yeah.
You see, we need to
clean them up
because they shall not stand there in the barn
no.
with a naked ass and feel ashamed.
No.
That's what she said.
You
wonder
her history.
Yeah, I know. I, that's what I say. And that was her first way to connect with me.
Yes.
To
right.
to start to tell, this is a bit about me.
My experience in the United States, both personal and professional, has taught me that authority figures almost never spontaneously reveal their deeper motives, especially when it risks casting them in a bad light. Thus, what was to come in the midst of Johnny signing the film's consent form, caught me off guard and taught me as much about the value of the Family Care Foundation's culture of transparency as anything else I was learning.
I say to Anki, no, you mustn't tell
Anki. Are you leaving too?
He has to do the cows.
Will you come back?
Yeah, you will be back. Hur länge är du ute? Timme?
For an hour.
Men han är här utanför.
You can,
he will be out here. We can call him in.
Okay. I film you signing it. Why not? This is drama.
This is drama.
This is drama. I'm serious.
Yes, of course it's drama. I'm serious too. And Daniel, I didn't mean it was wrong to cry. I hope you know that.
Okay, good. I think you just were. I don't know if you got uncomfortable or something.
No. I think I reacted by different reasons. First of all, I have a father who have cried a lot, and yeah. I don't think that has just been good for
right.
me as a child
right.
to have a father who cries, and I didn't. And he was constantly unhappy
right.
and anxious. So sometimes when grown-up people who I trust start to cry, I become that little child again, and I just feel, oh, you mustn't cry. I think that was what happened.
Right.
So that's one thing that has with my own personal private life.
Right.
And then I also maybe think I just wanted to maybe also just find out if it was okay for Johnny, what he thought about it. But first of all, it had to do with my own, because that's not easy for me yet, will never be. I work with it, but I mean, it's so...
And when I spoke about it, I see it is important to a child to see the father.
Of course it is.
It is in a healthy way.
As afternoon was turning into early evening, I decided to open up the sticky and all too often unspoken topic of psychiatric medications. In the United States, virtually all mental health programs rely on pharmaceuticals as the primary line of defense in the treatment of serious problems, to the point that people labeled with psychosis are expected to stay on antipsychotics for life, with consequences that are frequently devastating. Here, I sensed a different attitude.
When a person come here, they come from some place, maybe institution or something like that, and they have maybe a large amount of medication. You can't just cut it off. When they came here, we have to try to lower the level slowly, but to get there that you're not taking any medication anymore. It's a goal.
And
it's not everyone we succeed with, but it is a goal.
They will try. They will try.
They will try. With our help, they will try.
Yes. And they feel healthier without it.
Yeah.
But it's...
It's a long way.
Yes, it's a long way. It is.
How do you help them get off the medication?
No.
In English, ja.
Ja, man tar det på svenska.
Ja. En flicka hade ju i skåpet där och så trappade vi ner. Alltså hon gick och hämtade själv och så delade jag ut så hon fick en halv bara.
We made a routine with one girl who lived here. She had a pretty strong medication. Anki helped her to lower the doses by portion out the medication. And to cut them down to smaller and smaller pieces. This medication was giving severe headaches and such flash lightnings in the eyes, and could be mean to a real headache, like migraine or something like that. So it will have to take real slowly.
Yes.
And Anki helped her to lower the consumer of medication. And it succeeded. And
yes.
It was pure practical way to do it. So then you have to... You have to speak about it.
We do other things. We walk with our dogs and we sit down and take a cup of tea and we talked and we cried sometimes and we get out in the barn and milk our cows and we do very much things together. All the day we was together. You have so much in here and here. It's not all here, and you can't give them medicine for their feelings in their stomachs or feelings in your heart. You can shut down your brain so it works slower.
And where did you get the idea at the beginning that it's good to lower the medication?
Common sense and lots of help from Karina.
And the others.
Everyone at the office.
So their philosophy is it's best to be off the medication.
Yes.
And that was common sense to you?
To me it is, yes.
With Therese, we have a doctor that cares.
Yeah.
It listens to Therese, listens to Maria, and try to... take his part of the responsibility from his work and match it with what happens in Teresa's life.
He's lowering her medication now.
Yeah, because things work better in her ordinary life. So he's in the conversation with us and with Teresa.
But you have also very much invited him in your context.
Yeah.
So you have worked it through too.
Yeah.
He has long experience here now.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. He trusts your organization?
Yes, I think. So.
But in the beginning he didn't.
No.
I remember the first big meetings he was in. Like this.
Mm-hmm.
You forced him to come.
I don't know.
You forced him to become a member.
Yeah.
In the team.
He couldn't sit there and just participate.
No.
In my work as a therapist in New York City, I regularly referred clients to colleagues in private practice, only to discover, again and again, that many clinicians, because of sensationalized news stories, because of their training, or perhaps just because of their lack of experience, were afraid to work with people labeled with psychosis, especially those not on antipsychotics. Because of this, I wondered how Anki and Jonas, and the Family Care Foundation itself, dealt with the issue of fear.
Were you ever frightened having people with so many difficulties living in your home?
Never frightened. I don't think any one of us have been frightened. We have a person who has become some crimes and things that you could be frightened about. But we have never been frightened here. We don't ask me why. But there is no common sense in that.
Maybe there is.
Maybe. I don't know.
I met people at the psychiatric hospital in a psychiatric ward. And I told about our organization. I told about that every summer we have a summer party when we invite all the people in the organization, including clients and former clients and their families and all of it. And some of the participants, quite many of the participants.
Professionals?
Professional participants at the psychiatric ward, they were just stunned.
And they looked at me as if I talked about something very strange. And for me, this is not strange. For me, this is absolutely normal.
Once on a date we had with all the families in the Stiftelsen, one lady said, people think that we are crazy. Normal people lock their doors at night, so they, you know, quote, can't come in. We take them in and lock the door.
That's brilliant.
It's really good.
Yeah, it's true.
To adjust who is sane in that matter of speaking, I don't know, but...
But you grew from this experience.
Yeah, we do. A lot.
And I remember there was a psychiatrist and he said, so you mean that maybe it would be a good idea if we sometime, some of the nurses, for instance, had lunch together with the patients.
And your children are better for it?
Sometimes they are better for it. Now, when they've grown up, they are.
And he said it as if I was suggesting, you know, going to the moon. And I said, yes, I think that would be a very good idea. I'm sure you would find out new things about yourself and about the patients and about the way you do the work.
In the school time, they have maybe too much experience to cope with the rest of the students.
I see.
They have been a little too old for their age, maybe too soon.
They see things that...
As what is in common, they have been it too soon. But who said that common is best?
But he was just like this. And he said, and people said, so you mean that you bring your own children to this summer party, meeting your client and their children? And I said, yes, I do. I've done that for 22 years.
Our boys was very good to manipulation the teachers.
Very good.
They're good at manipulating the teachers.
Yeah.
Yes, they have learned.
They
so
do
much.
With the people with the teachers that no parents want them to do. We have many meetings and sittings and talking in telephones with teacher of one and the other. Strange thing that happens.
And people were just. As if I was telling a revolutionary, that is what I mean.
The teacher got answered in a way that they never expected a 10-year-old boy to do.
It was really tough sometimes, but it's now...
But as adult, grown
yes,
up,
yes,
I think they have a lot of good
yes.
of this.
Because they read people very good. They see at them and they are...
They see needs
yes.
that people have in a way that not a lot of people do.
In the United States, the mental health system puts a significant pressure, both legally and ethically, on therapists to prevent suicide in their clients. All too often, however, this results in clients being stripped of their autonomy and traumatized by the very systems aiming to help them. This led me to wonder how Anki and Jonas handled this delicate issue.
So no one ever killed themselves when they were here?
No.
No.
Did you ever have people here
but
go...
But they have tried before.
While here? Yeah. Or before they came here?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That was a question that we put in our heads when we started with this. There was some kind of a scare.
Scared, yes.
That someone might kill
scared,
them?
Yes. Scared, yeah, yeah. What will we do? What will happen with us? How we will feel. But we find a model to live after, and we have lived after that since then, and probably we will do it our lifetime out. But we said that, are we doing our best? Are we doing our best that is possible? And they chose to do this terrible thing anyway. Jump in the lake or hang themselves in a tree. Have we a clear conscience that we have done our best? Then that is their responsibility. They take that step.
I found myself feeling a deep sense of respect for Anki and Jonas, and the therapist part of me found myself wondering how it would have been for me as a therapist to have had them as therapeutic allies. And it made me wonder how this alliance was for the staff at the Family Care Foundation.
When I listened to you, I thought about it was here in this kitchen. I think it might have been, but it also might have been someone else who at the time were very crazy, or how to say it. Mm-hmm. And he was crawling around on the floor and making noises mm-hmm. impossible to understand. Mm-hmm. And I remember I asked you, Jonas, are you not afraid? And you said, there are much worse things to be afraid about in the world than a man who is crawling around on the floor being sad and confused. I have saved that memory and I think a lot about it. When I need strength.
When you are in a situation you feel afraid or what shall we do, or can we just leave this, what is right to think about, shall we phone the police, they live with these hard questions sometimes.
Right. You must admire them.
I do. Really, I do.
I think it's very much the basic things. Eat, sleep, a little physical exercise, some people who likes you. And if you get that as a base, you can start working with the difficult things.
And when we start to connect and the trust builds to one person in the family, and the other ones are not trusted, or they almost doesn't exist for this person, but I've seen it to one, and how it builds slowly, slowly. Builds, and next person in the family gets into this space, and it just puts me in to think again about, yeah, people need other people.
Psychosis is so much of isolation, so the best surroundings ought to be a family you live or people you live together with, not professional who all will new persons every morning, like a hospital or an institution, but a place where you share life.
Not just working together with clients, it's a way of living with them, share their lives and their experiences, and it's not just that we are therapists and supervisors, we are just human being sharing a life story.
As our meeting was heading toward the end, I wanted to know if Anki and Jonas had a specific person who had lived with them who summed up all the points we had explored. Although they had several people to choose from, they finally spoke about one woman who had been given up for lost by the traditional system.
This is a woman that, when she came here, she couldn't walk in the city or go into a store, supermarket. bank, which was very important to her, to have she get
a
credit card, a Visa card. That was the.
And she couldn't do any of that.
No. She couldn't. She hadn't the opportunity to get that, and she couldn't go anywhere without being arrested. People get afraid. People get scared. People felt threatened. Everywhere, on the bus, on the train, in the cab, when she came here.
Because she was so afraid.
She was afraid. Well, we can say that today,
yeah.
But then we couldn't say that. She was complete insane, mad, crazy. We had a breakfast meeting here, who lasted for 2.5 hours.
Mm.
First time we saw this woman. She entertained us for 2.5 hours. I don't think any one of us did get the opportunity to say at least one word. She spoke about women with frozen chickens under their hat. What's that? We didn't know.
One can really wonder, how come you let her come into your house? Who is the one who is crazy?
But one thing who is very important here, this woman was here from the beginning, 1 day, 2 days. Then she leaves to Gothenburg. And
several days.
Yes, and be there 4 days. Then she got here again. We
slowly.
Slowly.
Extended.
Slowly, yes. So
she got a break, we got a break.
Yes.
We could live our lives.
Yes, yes.
Slowly. During three and a half year, extended the amounts of days that she was here.
Yeah. For this woman.
Yeah.
And, what
and
is,
for us.
Yeah.
It was so much and so heavy and so frustrating for us. And
But it's calmed down.
Yeah.
It's calmed down.
So when she left here, what was she? How was she different?
Oh, we can sit, sir.
She have been here and visit us. She several times
since she left.
Yeah.
And what happened to her life?
It's much better.
She has a credit card.
Yes, she went to United States.
Yes,
we
get a postcard.
Yes.
We get a postcard.
Yes.
Her sister lives in Los Angeles.
Yes.
Yeah.
We get a postcard from her when she was in Los Angeles, and she told us have. Went by fly from Sweden to Holland, from Holland over to the States and down to Los Angeles. Thank you.
For the help.
Yeah.
Thank you for the help.
And when she left here, was she on medication?
No.
She will never have.
She had no medication.
No, she had no.
When she came here, she didn't.
She refused.
She was one of them who didn't have medication.
Mm-hmm. She refused.
There have been
medication.
Both.
So let me ask you this. I asked Karina this woman.
Yeah.
If she was in mainstream psychiatry, what would her diagnosis have been when she came here?
The diagnosis was schizophrenia. She was diagnosed schizophrenia.
Really?
Yeah.
And when she left, this diagnosis, still she could still have this diagnosis?
No. Oh, no.
No.
No, no, no. No.
Let me ask you this. Do you think of people with diagnosis? Do you think schizophrenia, bipolar, this ADHD, depression?
No.
I didn't think so at all.
No? Do you know about these diagnoses?
A little
very
bit.
Very, very little.
Do you care?
No.
Why not?
Why? Why? It didn't help me. You got the people in your home, and we should live together and share everything. I have no use of the schizophrenia or borderlines or
psychotics.
The same. No. I don't know why.
It's not to negligera I would say.
Neglect.
Neglect. We don't neglect diagnosis. It's not that. But for us, they don't doing anything. We haven't the education to know what it is. We haven't wanted to educate us to know what it is. We have no use for it. What should it bring us for good? I don't know.
Although it was very personal, I wanted, before we closed our meeting, to bring up one final taboo topic, money. I knew they weren't getting rich from their healing work, but I didn't know a single other place in the world where such gifted healers weren't even supporting themselves from their work. And I wondered how they felt about it.
Do you feel you deserve to be paid more for what you do?
Sometimes, in the short minutes. Yes, sometimes. But not in the...
Not in the general. No. Not in the general. And I think...
I think it's enough. It's good.
Because you don't get paid a lot, right? It's
not
much.
No. We don't get paid a lot. No, we don't. And that am I saying here with the boss sitting right next to me. But it's but it is...
That's why they're strange to ask.
Yeah. It's not that kind of relation that I feel that I have with Karina and anyone there, down there. It's not employee and employer.
Mm.
It's something different. I can't put a word on it, what it is, but surely, sometimes, yes, we felt underpaid. But if you look at it on the whole, who could pay you for your live your life? What would you put for numbers on that?
I don't know about you, but I'm getting tired.
Yes, I'm very tired.
I've been talking for 3.5 hours.
I'm sorry. Well, you want to have the last word because you just came back?
I don't know what I should say.
Yeah.
Bye. It went well in the barn.
Oh, it has been great to listen to you and to sit.
All the cattle are happy.
Good.
I hope.
And the bull too?
Yeah, the bull too.